In this video, I'll discuss my three favorite moments from the final fourth movement of Brahms' first symphony in C minor. My last three videos dealt with this symphony's first three movements, so you may want to watch those first if you haven't already. Like the first movement, this final movement begins with a slow introduction that previews most of the important thematic material from the ensuing sonata form movement. I'm giving three of these themes special nicknames. The first is the famous melody we heard at the beginning of the video that I'm calling the Beethoven theme for reasons I'll explain later. The second I'm calling the Alphorn theme. And the third I'm calling the trombone chorale theme. This slow introduction is unusually large, comprising a sizable portion of the entire movement, and it contains the first of my three favorite moments, the gorgeous initial appearance of the Alphorn theme, one of the most iconic passages in the symphonic literature, that I may have spoiled for you a second ago by playing it out of context. The movement begins in an entirely different, tragic or foreboding mood, with the combination of this dark blue descending four-note scale motif that plays an important supporting role in almost every section of the movement, and this minor mode disguised version of the beginning of the Beethoven theme. Remember from the first movement that Brahms loves to expand and transform themes, and that he commonly first introduces a theme as a small fragment of what it eventually becomes. This is followed by a disquieting pizzicato section that used to terrify me when I listened to this symphony as a child, since it conjured up images of sinister imps creeping up behind me. We then hear another entry of the disguised Beethoven theme and dark blue motif, followed by more of this frightening pizzicato material. Thank you. The energy now begins to build toward the first of my favorite moments. And notice again how Brahms precedes the introduction of the full Alphorn theme with these smaller fragments of just its first three notes. This crescendo also consists of various versions of the dark blue motif. To save time, I'm not going to point out when this motif is inverted or changed rhythmically. And this new green motif that will also return throughout the remainder of the movement. Near the end of this exciting crescendo, we hear faster, more urgent fragments of the Alphorn theme, this time more rhythmically similar to the actual theme. This culminates in these three offbeat sforzati, the last of which is emphasized by a powerful timpani roll, and the return of the purple chromatic motif from the first three movements, played now by the contrabassoon and lower strings. In a sense, I consider this purple motif to be the glue that holds this symphony together. In this case, it functions as a remarkably short transition from the frantic turmoil of this crescendo to the sublime entrance of the now complete Alphorn theme played by the horn. As I stated before, this is one of the most iconic moments in the symphonic literature, and it has always reminded me of the sun emerging from the clouds after a violent thunderstorm. The reason I and others call this the Alphorn theme is that in 1868, about halfway through this symphony's 20-year gestation, Brahms was visiting the Alps and he sent this now famous postcard to fellow composer and kindred spirit, Clara Schumann, that reads, when translated into English, "Thus blew the Alphorn today," accompanied by a transcription of the very theme we just heard. Remember that horns and brass instruments in general are limited to the notes of the harmonic series. The notes in between can be produced if the instrument has valves or a slide, or, especially in the case of natural horns, if the bell is stopped with the hand. Since the Alphorn has no valves or slide, and the bell can't really be stopped by the performer's hand without stretchy superpowers, traditional Alphorn melodies tend to be triadic, or in the upper range tend to sound Lydian, due to this specific note of the harmonic series that, if C is the fundamental, sounds like an out-of-tune G-flat or F-sharp, at least to most of us listeners accustomed to modern tuning. For example, listen to this Lydian-sounding tune played by these actual Alphornists in Switzerland. Notice that both the tune we just heard and the Brahms theme only use these six notes of the harmonic series, including the Lydian raised fourth, notated by Brahms as an F-sharp. Also notice this theme's other most characteristic feature. this folksy Scotch snap rhythm in its first bar. This first entrance of the full Alphorn theme, with its shimmering accompaniment from the strings, is also one of Brahms's most Wagnerian moments. Specifically, it reminds me of the famous passage near the end of Das Rheingold, when Donner, the god of thunder, summons the mist with his hammer, and we hear a similar horn call with the same kind of shimmering string accompaniment. To Brahms, the flute now restates the Alphorn theme, accompanied by these additional figures played by the bassoons and horns. Now for a rare moment of performance critique. If you happen to be an orchestral flautist, for the love of Brahms, don't play with this much vibrato. When in doubt, if it's a delicate passage like this one, and you sound like old-timey Donald Duck being throttled by a trombone, it's probably too much. Anyway, speaking of trombones, this introduces the third of my nicknamed themes, the trombone chorale theme, played of course by the trombones, but also accompanied by bassoons, as is common in orchestral brass choruses. I mentioned in my video about the immense fugal finale of Bruckner's Fifth Symphony that he finished around the same time as this Brahms Symphony, that both works have a brass chorale in the finale that returns triumphantly in the coda section. Spoiler alert, that will be the third of my favorite moments from this Brahms movement. Recall that in the Bruckner movement, the theme becomes one of the subjects of a colossal fugal section, comprising a large portion of the overall movement. This Brahms chorale, by contrast, mysteriously disappears completely for the remainder of the movement until its triumphant return in the coda. But notice that like the Bruckner chorale, this Brahms theme wanders tonally. It is followed by a now imitative return of the Alphorn theme to end the slow introduction. After this enormous slow introduction, the exposition section finally begins with the Beethoven theme, now fully expanded and now in the major mode, combined with the purple chromatic motif. ¶¶ Some of you might already know why I nicknamed this the Beethoven theme, since this portion is an obvious homage to the famous Ode to Joy theme from Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. I'll play you first the Beethoven and then the Brahms again for comparison. This similarity was mentioned to Brahms himself, to which he supposedly replied, "Any ass can see that." Of course, great composers do this to each other all the time, and if you've watched my Mahler Soundalikes video from a few years ago, then you know about Mahler's homage to this homage at the beginning of his Third Symphony. Returning to Brahms, notice how he just used these fragments of the theme to create imitative counterpoint to the theme itself. This use of fragments excised from various areas of this theme continues throughout the remainder of the movement. The sonata form of this movement is atypical, because at the end of the exposition section, it jumps straight to the recapitulation section. To make up for this lack of a development section, Brahms greatly expands and develops the middle portion of the recapitulation section, and this expanded portion contains the second of my favorite moments. However, to adequately understand this moment, we must first be familiar with the non-expanded analogous portion of the exposition section. So, back to the beginning of the exposition section, the Beethoven theme is restated by the woodwinds, crescendoing to a more energetic entry that immediately fragments the theme. Notice that these sforzati fragments are just faster versions of this portion of the original theme. These entries are punctuated by this new orange leaping motif and its inversion, and are followed by this new mustard-colored dotted figure combined with its metrically shifted inversion. Launch into this contrapuntal passage featuring the dark blue motif, sometimes combined with this gray three-note addition. This leads to the surprise and brief return of the Alphorn theme, again played imitatively by the flute and horn. It's interesting to me that this theme was so prominent in the slow introduction, but now plays such a tiny role in the exposition section, functioning more as a transition to the actual second theme, played by the first violins and accompanied by repeated entries of the dark blue motif. Thank you. So, just to review, we heard the seemingly unimportant orange and mustard-colored figures, a contrapuntal section based on the dark blue motif, a fleeting return of the Alphorn theme, and the pink second theme of the exposition section. Now let's jump straight to the recapitulation section to see how Brahms expands and develops this portion. We'll begin with the orange leaping motif and the mustard-colored motif reappearing exactly as they did in the exposition section, but then they immediately go rogue, launching into a much more intense, expanded contrapuntal section, again featuring the descending dark blue motif, but this time tied to the orange leaping motif to create an imitative subject. The intensity briefly subsides as the dark blue motif fades into an accompanimental role. Remember that I discussed this same maneuver in the first movement. With the same four-note fragment of the Beethoven theme entering imitatively in the woodwinds. This less intense interlude also features these drawn-out, soaring syncopated entries of the dark blue subject, played over these still somewhat agitated, faster entries from the violins. Notice this abrupt, unexpected pause before the contrapuntal section roars back to life even more intensely than before. I hate to interrupt one of Brahms's greatest escalations of tension, but I have to mention in the section we just heard the slightly more surreptitious homage to another famous symphonic finale, that of Mozart's Jupiter Symphony. Remember the orange theme from my video on that movement. Notice how Brahms also uses this near-identical configuration as the subject of close imitative counterpoint, though never as densely overlapping as the four-part close stretto in the Mozart movement. Brahms actually wasn't the first composer to pilfer this contrapuntal subject from Mozart. This is the opening of the finale of Robert Schumann's E-flat major piano quartet, composed in 1842. Later in the movement, he uses this subject in a similar three-part close stretto, in my opinion, an obvious nod to Mozart. Returning to Brahms, we now continue building to the most tense moment of the symphony, beginning with these same four-note fragments of the Beethoven theme, answered by these ferocious entries of the dark blue motif, and intensified even further by these sforzati on the downbeats from the timpani and brass. The tension continues to build with even smaller fragments of the Beethoven theme, now with just three notes, and eventually with only two. Remember that everything we've heard so far is a huge developmental expansion of that tiny contrapuntal portion of the exposition section. But now we move on to an expansion of the tiny, fleeting Alphorn theme transition. It begins with these forceful, offbeat fragments that culminate in my favorite moment, when, after a dramatic rest, the whole orchestra plays this fortissimo note, including this violent timpani roll that in the space of only two bars decrescendos to piano and shifts from near maximum frenetic intensity to sublime tranquility. This is reminiscent of the loud timpani roll from the slow introduction that coincided with the purple chromatic motif and introduced the first entrance of the Alphorn theme. Now, in the place of the purple chromatic motif, Brahms uses the beginning of the Alphorn melody itself, played simultaneously with its own rhythmic augmentation in the lower instruments. This introduces a reprise of the gorgeous imitative entries of the full Alphorn theme, this time accompanied by these rhythmic figures derived from the Beethoven theme. Finally, this section dwindles to the quiet entry of the pink second theme. But notice another of my favorite moments, when the dark blue motif that accompanies the pink theme unexpectedly enters a bar too early. Now listen to this entire breathtaking passage. We finally made it to the third of my favorite moments, the overwhelming coda section, with the triumphant return of the trombone chorale theme. Before I discuss it, let's very quickly time travel back to the remainder of the exposition section that I skipped before. Just listen to this tiny portion that brings back the green theme from the slow introduction, now combined with these light green triplets that I suppose could be called the closing motif of the exposition, since they dominate the remainder of the section. Both of these green motifs return in the coda section, hence the time travel. Before jumping back to the coda section, while I was making the painful decision to skip the last large portion of the exposition section, I couldn't resist commenting on this oboe solo that contains part of the recently introduced pink theme, but also contains this tiny fragment of the Lydian portion of the Alphorn theme. The recapitulation section, like the exposition section, ends with the light green closing motif and the orange leaping motif, but now pivots to these mysterious fragments of the Beethoven theme that lead to the final giant crescendo that begins with these sinister entries of the Beethoven theme played by the contrabassoon, bass trombone, and lower strings. Notice that this is the only time the Beethoven theme is played in the minor mode, except for those initial entries at the beginning of the slow introduction. As the tempo accelerates, the theme is fragmented again, this time just repeating this final falling third, leading to this più allegro march-like section, also based on a different fragment of the Beethoven theme, with the dark blue and purple chromatic motifs thrown in almost haphazardly. As we listen to these three-note fragments of the Beethoven theme, I have to mention that this specific three-note half-step motif plays such an important role in all three of Brahms's subsequent symphonies that I almost consider it the glue that holds all four symphonies together as a cycle. As you'll find out soon in my very next Brahms video, the second symphony opens with this motif. And it plays a starring role in almost every section of that movement. Here's just one example. The finale of the Second Symphony also begins with this motif. And it's also important in that movement, for example, in this section. The opening movement of the Third Symphony contains this passage. The finale of the Third Symphony also begins with the motif. It's also an important element of the opening movement of the Fourth Symphony. And it even dominates one of the Passacaglia variations from the finale of the Fourth Symphony. Of course, Brahms was fond of this as a contrapuntal motif, even in his non-symphonic works. I promise this will be the last example from the opening movement of the Opus 8 Piano Trio. Now that I've given you a little preview of the remainder of this video series, let's finally talk about likely my favorite moment of the entire First Symphony, when these march-like fragments, and fragments from other areas of the Beethoven theme, build to the overwhelmingly triumphant return of the trombone chorale theme, now played fortissimo by most of the orchestra. This show-stopping moment is followed by these syncopated fragments of the green theme, difficult at first to recognize as such, until a few bars later when the full theme enters and then repeats, combined this time with the returning pink theme. Now the light green closing motif has a cameo, followed by these tutti outbursts, based also on the pink theme, finally leading back to the triumphant march-like fragments of the Beethoven theme, to end this exhilarating coda section and resolve the turmoil and strife from the entire preceding symphony.